didn't know today would be our last, or that I'd have to say goodbye to you so fast. I'm so numb I can't feel anymore. I'm praying you'd just walk back through that door and tell me that I was only dreaming. You're not really gone as long as I believe. There will be another angel around the throne tonight. Your love lives on inside of me, and I will hold on tight. It's not my place to question, only God knows why. I'm just jealous of the angels around the throne tonight. Always made my troubles feel so small, and you were always there to catch me when I'd fall. In a world where heroes come and go, well, God just took the only one I know. So I'll hold you as close as I can, longing for the day when I see your face again. But until then, God must need another angel around the throne tonight. Your love lives on inside, and I will hold on tight. It's not my place to question, only God knows why. I'm just jealous of the angels around the throne tonight, singing hallelujah.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. I would like to thank all of you for being here today to come celebrate the life of an extraordinary man, Dr. Merle Bouma. He was our friend, our brother, and to some of you, a father and a shining example of life. We're going to begin our program today with an honor guard. Won't you please rise for this ceremony?
Good afternoon, everyone. Please remain standing for our opening invocation. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one God. In the name of the I am that I am, and by the love of the light which lighteth every man and woman that cometh into the world, we come before thy throne, O God, to give glory and praise for thy will, thy all-encompassing love, thy action here below as above, fulfilling cosmic law and cosmic purpose within each heart. Our Father who art in heaven, we pray for the souls who come together this day in heaven and on earth to salute the glory of the risen Christ in our beloved Merle Bouma and all who follow him in the regeneration. May light and love increase in all hearts because thy love is fulfilled in him this day. We pray for all who mourn that they might be comforted. We pray that the Holy Comforter might be that spirit of living truth that defines and redefines individual destiny. And we pray for understanding that we might share and know thy plan for each one. In the name of the Father and of the Mother and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, we thank thee, O God, for thy infinite mercy unto all. Amen. Please be seated. Our scriptural reading is Psalm 121. I will lift up mine eyes unto the hills, from whence cometh my help. My help cometh from the Lord, which made heaven and earth. He will not suffer thy foot to be removed. He that keepeth thee will not slumber. Behold, he that keepeth Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is thy keeper. The Lord is thy shade upon thy right hand. The sun shall not smile on thee by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord shall preserve thee from all evil. He shall preserve thy soul. The Lord shall preserve thy going out and thy coming in from this time forth and even forevermore. Let us sing hymn number 87, if you have a songbook, Onward Christian Soldier. This is in your bulletin to honor our beloved Merle, who served in the Army. Please rise.
Soldiers marching as to war with the cross of Jesus. Go.
you. Please be seated. It was Jesus who said, "Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. And whither I go, ye know, and the way ye know. I am the way, the truth, the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die." Reverend David Dry will now give our eulogy.
Merle Bouma was born July 8, 1933, in a little town called Hull, way up in northwest of Iowa. He was the 10th of 12 children. Merle was an identical twin, and his brother was Marvin. There were six girls, and six boys. How about that? They were a Dutch family in a Dutch community. Merle said, "We were Dutch to the core." His family were Calvinists. Merle's parents, his father Peter and mother Lena, were farmers, and they and all the kids lived and worked the land. Merle said they did everything. They farmed pigs, chickens, cows. We had a dairy business, milking cows. My father and older brothers grew vegetables. Merle didn't like milking cows, and he said that milking cows encouraged him eventually to leave the farm. I don't think they had automatic milkers back in those days. He went to high school in Edgerton and then went to college for a couple of years. He then wanted to leave, so he got a job as an orderly in a hospital in Minneapolis. It was the start of his interest in all things medical. Eventually, he was the assistant to the pathologist in the hospital and helped him when he did the autopsies. He enjoyed learning about the medical field. Interestingly, Merle got to stitch up the bodies after the autopsies. He did such a good job that the pathologist told him he would make a good surgeon, but Merle wasn't interested in being a surgeon. Now you can see why Doc knew so much about the human body. He decided he didn't want to work in the hospital for the rest of his life, so he went back to college. Then he was drafted into the army and ended up in Germany. He really loved his time in Germany and learned a lot about culture and history, and he received his discharge in 1956. After getting out of the army, Merle continued his interest in healing. He went back to college and then went to chiropractic school. He worked in a hospital at night and as a night guard, but he actually mostly got to study while his patients slept. He thought that this was just great. He would go to classes in the morning to mid-afternoon, then went home to sleep, and then went to his night job, and then started all over again. Where did he take his nap? I couldn't quite see that. He loved studying chiropractic and healing. He was very disciplined. He got good grades, and he graduated from Palmer Chiropractic College in 1964. Merle worked in Minneapolis for 3 years as a chiropractor. He loved Minneapolis, but then a fellow chiropractor in Raton, New Mexico, convinced him to come and work with him there. Now, Raton, New Mexico is about 90 miles south of Colorado Springs, where the headquarters of the Summit Lighthouse was, and the home of the Messengers. By this time, Merle was reading spiritual literature in his spare time, and it had begun his search for the White Brotherhood after he read a book called Brother of the Third Degree. Merle worked for this chiropractor in New Mexico for about 6 months, but it didn't work out, and he did not want to compete with his fellow chiropractor in a small town, so he helped a friend to run his printing press. He learned all about printing, and he had a lot of fun with that. Then another friend told him he should come back into chiropractic and invited him to come join a practice in Colorado Springs. So he went there in 1972. He was still looking for the White Brotherhood, but did not realize that his search was nearly over. When Merle arrived in Colorado Springs at the chiropractic office of his friend, he met his future wife, Margie, who was the receptionist. Then 6 weeks after moving to Colorado Springs, a former patient of Merle's in Minneapolis met someone who gave him the phone number of Elizabeth Clare Prophet and the Great White Brotherhood in Colorado Springs. So she called Merle, gave him the number, and Merle called and spoke to Elizabeth, who invited him to the Sunday service. Merle went to the service and liked what he found there. He was met at the door by Florence Miller, who is now the Ascended Lady Master Christine. Then he went to the sermon and lecture by Mark Prophet. He recognized Mark as a messenger of the Great White Brotherhood. He loved hearing about the Ascended Masters in heaven. It was the beginning of a lifelong passion. Merle really loved the teaching, so he soon introduced them to Margie. They started to spend time together and started dating. Eventually, Margie came to the Summit Lighthouse. She enjoyed hearing about the angels and the elementals. When Margie met Mark Prophet, she just adored him. He was like the father that she never had. It was Mark who actually prompted them to get married. They had been dating, and one day Mark said to Merle, "That's a pretty nice girl you have there. You ought to do something about that." So Merle and Margie got married after the Freedom Class, July 9th, 1972, in the chapel at La Tourelle. Merle was 38 when they married, and Margie was 3 years older. Mark actually performed the wedding himself. And Merle said that Mark got a real kick out of doing the wedding and enjoyed himself immensely. Merle became father to Margie's two teenage children, Marlene and Tom. Merle and Margie were married 38 years, and it was a happy marriage. Merle said Margie was well organized and helped keep him in line. She provided the discipline and home life that he needed. They became regulars at La Tourelle. They loved to go to the Four Winds restaurant that Mark often frequented. They said it was fun to just sit and chat with him and just talk about things. Mark was easy to get to know and seemed like just an ordinary guy, but he really had something special about him. He seemed to be able to know what was on your mind and had a way of addressing your concerns in his sermons and in his lectures. Merle had a close relationship with Mark. He loved the Master, El Moria, and Saint Germain. Merle's relationship with Mark continued after Mark passed on and made his ascension in February 1973. And by this time, Merle had gotten to know Mrs. Prophet very well also. He was amazed at how calm and composed she was when she conducted her husband's memorial service and remarked that she truly had the Holy Spirit. Merle and Margie really missed Mark after he left. They felt like he had been the rock of Gibraltar for the staff and the community. But they really appreciated how Mrs. Prophet continued on after Mark's passing and the movement began to grow. Merle said that for years he would always ask Mark for help in all kinds of matters, great and small, and he would always felt that Lanella was close by, felt that he never let him down. He had lots of stories to tell about Mark when he was alive and how he helped him after he had passed on. At Elizabeth Clare Prophet's invitation, Merle and Margie joined the staff at the Summit Lighthouse in the fall of 1974, and they moved to Santa Barbara when the organization moved there that year. Margie worked in accounting, and Merle would come and treat the staff. Then the organization moved to Pasadena and later to Camelot in Malibu, and the Boumas moved there too. Merle had a chiropractic office in town, and he also treated the staff on site. And I'm going to confess, my first visit to see Doc was in March of 1979. Dr. Bouma also treated both the messengers in his time, and he said many of his patients felt that he had the gift of healing. Mrs. Prophet told Merle that he should remember that he was not the healer, but that God would do the work through him. So Merle was quiet with a dry sense of humor. He could be a bit stubborn, but he was devoted and determined. He said, "I have studied all my life. I always read books and articles and kept up with the literature. I would often go to courses and get more training. I feel that you have to do that in this field." He would always say to his patients, "The body can heal itself." He worked hard at being a good chiropractor, and his patients appreciated him for the help and relief that he provided. Merle also paid tribute to his mentors through the years. And these were some of his comments about them. He said, "These people have these skills to develop their work, but they don't always develop the necessary skills for teaching. They just live it. But they can tell you some great things. You just have to sit down and listen to them." And that is what I feel has been the greatest gift of God for me in my line of work, that he placed me under these people. And it always happened that I met them from something that Mrs. Prophet encouraged me to do. The Boumas moved here to Livingston in 1990, and Merle set up his chiropractic office at 118 Calendar Street here in Livingston, next to the Fire Hall Athletic Club. He practiced there for over 26 years. How many of you have been touched by those healing hands? I think we can all witness to the amazing experience that we had on Dr. Bouma's table. He's been a part of our community for 45 years. He was part of the group that founded St. Mark's Church that we're in today. And he served on the Board of Trustees for many years here. He was a regular at the quarterly conferences and always supported the church and its initiatives. In 2010, Merle's wife Margie passed away peacefully at the age of 80 after a long illness, and Merle was at her side. He continued on with his work practice and was always hardworking and diligent. He retired toward the end of 2016 and moved to Bozeman. He was 83 years old and had been practicing chiropractic for over 50 years. To the delight of his friends, he attended the Easter class in Corwin Springs. On May 12th, he had an unexpected stroke and was admitted to the hospital, and he passed away 6 days later on May 17th in Bozeman. He is survived by his stepdaughter, Marlene Harlow, and her children, Jennifer and Crystal, and his stepson, Tom, and his wife, Debbie, and their children, Brian, Matthew, and Grady, and he's also survived by his adopted daughter and close friend, Marion O'Neill, and her daughter, Shay. His brother, Ken, who is with us today, you'll hear from Ken. His two sisters, numerous grandnephews and nieces, and many extended family and friends. For so many of us, he was simply just known as Doc. His gentle care and touch kept many of us going when the aches and pains of everyday life would catch up to us. Thanks, Doc, for always being there for us, being an example of the path and sharing your stories with each of us of the things you loved about life. You were one of a kind. May God bless you.
Thank you very much, David. We now would like to have our testimonies. We know we have many, many people who would love to say some words about Dr. Bouman. We're asking you, please, to share your thoughts at our reception after our service with the family and friends. And we do have a little folder. You can put something if you'd like to write a few words, you can put that in the folder. So I'd like to invite Ken Bouma up to say a few words about his beloved brother.
Thank you. I'm the young, the baby brother of Merle. Ken Bouma. Merle was born in 1933. I don't recall that because I'm just going by hearsay because 15 months later I was born, so. We had 12 kids. I thought that was a normal sized family at that time. And 6 boys. I was the last of 6 boys. They kept working on the boys until they got it right. So, the boys on the farm were supposed to take care of the farm and do all the farm work, and of course, being the smallest, I got the tail end of the stuff that nobody else wanted to do. But that worked out. Pretty soon they all left. But Merle was a very unique person. He had a twin brother, and those guys would fight all the time. They fought about what shirt they were going to wear and what. She would buy the same kind of shirts, but one was wrinkled and the other one wasn't, so they would fight over that before we went to church. And they would fight who had to drive the tractor, you know, because they would take turns driving the tractor. After about 3 weeks, Merle said to me, "You know, I don't really care to drive that stupid tractor. So I'm just going to hang out with you and paint the barn and do whatever we felt like doing and take a break." And that worked out pretty well, except for the hoeing thistles. That was one of the things that we didn't like to do very well. But it became very clear that Merle was not in love with farming, so he went on to high school. His twin brother stopped in the 10th grade. And so Merle stopped, continued on, started in Hall Christian School when it started first grade. And then in 1941, we moved to Minnesota from Iowa. And that was kind of confusing to me because in Iowa we had electricity. And in Minnesota we didn't have electricity, so we had to watch television by candlelight. That was a little difficult. But We had a big farm and a huge house. We only had 12 people, 12 kids. We had a great big 3-bedroom house. I think I slept with 4 other people in my bed because I was smaller, so I'd always have to sleep with 3. But that went over pretty well. Pretty soon they all grew up and left. Later on, I had a house bed all by myself. Merle went on to high school, continued on to Calvin College, and then stopped working and worked in Minneapolis for a while, and then he got drafted into the Army. I think he fought the World War II in 1956. But he got done fighting that war, and he came back and went back to Calvin College. But at that time, I decided I wanted to quit farming too, and the only one left was my sister Joy is with us today. Joy, she didn't want to farm, so and her husband didn't want to take over the farm, so they sold it. So anyway, with Merle and I went to Calvin College together. We decided to buy a house, so we found an old junky house that needed work. But since we were a farm boy, you know, we know how to lift a hammer so we remodeled that house, and we rehabbed that house, and we sold it. We're going to sell it. But before we got to around selling it, Merle came to me one time and he said, you know, I want to go to chiropractor school. I said, chiropractor school? What's that? Well, of course, we've been going to chiropractors all our life. And so he said, there's Davenport, Iowa. Place called, I can't remember the Palmer Chiropractic School. And so I said, yeah, go ahead. That's probably a good idea. He was telling me that on a Sunday morning. But he says, tomorrow they start. He said, I don't have a car. Well, I was fooling around with cars at that time. I had a perfectly good Dodge car. I sold it to him, perfectly good car, for $50. I think it was only about 15 years old. So he took off with that car and made it all the way from Grand Rapids to Holland, which is 30 miles. So he brought it back, and I went out for dinner with my sisters, and I came home, and he was sitting there looking really depressed. So I said, what's the problem? Well, he says, I broke down. The engine went out, made it back here. I said, well, I just decided to forget it. I'm not going to school. I said, go ahead. I got a car. You can use my car. I can walk to school. I can borrow my buddy's car. And so, and it was a perfectly good 54 Chevrolet. You know. That made it all the way to Davenport. And so he brought it back Christmas vacation, and after that, you know, after he graduated, he went to Wisconsin somewhere. We kept in contact all the time, and he went to Wisconsin. He came back from Wisconsin, or he went from Wisconsin to Colorado to Minneapolis, all over. I didn't even keep track of it, other than the fact he'd call me about once a month and tell me what he was doing. But he was always interested in furthering his education. And it was just amazing how many seminars and stuff he went to. He just continued it. And he practiced on me. That was pretty good. I'd go up to see him at least once a year. So he continued doing that, and then finally ended up in Montana. I thought, what are you doing in Montana? Oh, there's a lot of cowboys there that that need fixing up. So I really had a lot of contact with him in the last few years. He just seemed to know everything about the body. He knows how it works, and then of course he sold me all these vitamins and minerals and I can't hold it all in my hands, so I had two hands. He's kept me healthy, so healthy as I am right now. But I'm only 83 years old, so. Oh, I'm only 82, I guess. Let me see that. Yeah, I'm 82. But anyway, we really appreciated him, each other. He'd come to Michigan about once a year, and he would treat all of the nieces and nephews, and they were all just so proud of him. We'd go to breakfast or we'd go to a party, and he would start talking, and everybody would gather around from Michigan and listen to his lectures and what the body was doing, what it didn't want to do, and what it should do. And, okay. So, you know, we go to breakfast. My oldest sister, she started complaining about some back problems she had, and she was only about 89 years old. So he said he'd treat her. I was waiting in the car. I thought, they're standing outside that restaurant. Talked to her for an hour and a half about. And then everybody else crowded around, and he was continuing to talking to everybody else and all their problems. And every time he always stayed with me at my house, and so he wanted to practice on everybody. So I had an old massage table, so we'd carry him over to the massage table in my living room, and he would work on him. And he did it free. I wouldn't charge him lodging either. I thought, you know, at least they could pay me for it. Anyway, that was my brother Merle Bouma. And we love him to this day. We had a lot of fun together when we were young, and everything from hoeing thistles to painting barns and all the other fun stuff we did. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Ken. Thank you. Shay O'Neill, she put together this beautiful slideshow that you've been watching, and she has a witness.
In case you all were wondering, yes, I am the girl from all the photos in his office. Dr. Bouma was a very special man to me. I'm gonna try not to cry. I told my mom I wouldn't cry. But of course that's impossible. Dr. Bouma was a man that harbored great amounts of love in his heart. And when he hired my mother years ago, I don't think he knew how much love he exactly had left to give. But boy, am I extremely grateful that my mother and I got to receive a lot of it. His gift was incredible, and I'm sure a lot of you can agree with me. Dr. Bouma, I first met him when I hurt my ankle at soccer practice one day, and I just knew him as my mother's boss. And my mother and I went through a lot the year before she got hired from him, and I called her one day after soccer practice and told her, "Mom, I think I really, really messed up my ankle." I could hear Dr. Bouma in the background, "No, no, 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 no. it'll be fine. Just bring her in. It'll be fine. Throughout my life, I heard that often. No, no, it'll be fine. I'll work it out. It'll be fine. He was not only concerned about my health, because I was and still am very, very accident prone, but that was a whole different reason why I was thankful for him. He was also very concerned about my dreams. He knew that I was raised by a single mother. He knew that I had a very bitter childhood. And he also knew much more about myself than I even knew. So every time I had a crazy idea about what I wanted to do next with my life, especially after high school, I'd run into the office and I'd tell my mom, hey, I'm gonna go here. Hey, mom, I'm gonna get certified in this. And sometimes my mom would look at me and say, no. And Dr. Bouma would always stand behind her doing this. He always seemed to tell me yes. I don't know if it was my puppy dog eyes or anything, but he always seemed to tell me yes. He'd share my excitement, and I took it for granted while he was here to comfort me and be a confidant for my mother and I. People often say to never have regrets, but yet we all do. And one of mine is not being able to tell Dr. Merle Bouma, thank you enough. Yes, you've all seen the photos in his office with my thank yous written across them for the various Rodeo Queen titles he helped me achieve and the personal growth he helped me develop. But those photos were not an ounce of what the thank you that that man deserved. He healed many, and he took the time to tell everyone about their bodies, and apparently it wasn't just in my lifetime, it was in the hearsay of 1933 it started. And he always, always provided a laugh to those who would listen, even if you were sitting there against your will sometimes, because he was just that stubborn. Even though the end was a little bumpy, the ride was one of a lifetime. The day before his passing, I sat and read a book that I'm currently reading. It's Killing Kennedy by Bill O'Reilly, in case any of you have read it before. We always shared a passion for history. I might not seem like it, but I'm really fascinated with the United States presidents. And he would always tell me about certain times in history, but from his point of view, and boy, was it unique. I loved listening to his stories of what life was like while he was going to chiropractor school, and his stories of sitting at night while his patients were asleep, because the hospital he worked at was a mental hospital, and he had some pretty doozy stories. I was like, how in the world did you get any studying done? I made time, Shay. I made time. Anyways, while I read to him that day, he held my hand the entire time. And he had this smirk on his face that you see in this picture. And it was a smile that warmed my heart. Everyone around him knew that it was coming to an end, and I think he knew it too. But that smile was just the style of Merle Bouma. He was a man surrounded by actual peace and love, and that's how he left the earth. Surrounded by so much peace and love. That's the Dr. Merle Bouma I will remember. The one with the small smirk and the smiling eyes ready to discuss just about anything he could with anyone that would listen. A man that helped me reach so many goals and to try and stay healthy, because as I stated earlier, I am very clumsy. I hope that you all have a little piece of him like that that you'll remember. And he often told me, never let that leave your heart. I also want to say that while I was watching my PowerPoint that I created and worked hard on, I started crying and I didn't think I would, and I got really upset, and then I started to hear all of you sing. And it really wrapped a warm hug around my heart. So I want to say thank you to all of you for being here today.
Thank you very much, Shay. Beautiful. Now we'd like to hear from a fellow chiropractic friend, John Karp.
Well, I had the great opportunity to work with Dr. Bouma about 10 years ago. And this was with Dr. Durr when she was working here. Is Dr. Durr here? Yeah, she's back there. And this was also when Marion had started working with Dr. Bouma. And we had some amazing experiences with Doc, as we call him, particularly Marion and I. And but don't worry, Marion, I won't repeat any of those stories. But I just have to share a couple stories about cases that he had. We all know he was a great clinician. I mean, he was one of the few chiropractors that could analyze your kidney potassium level, you know, through blood through muscle testing. But beyond that, beyond his clinical skills, he was a great healer. So I just have a couple stories that I recall from when I worked with him of patients that came in, and I was just amazed at how he dealt with them. The first one was a woman who came in. She was in her 70s or so, and she was quite spry for her age, very fit, and she was kind of a salt of the earth type person. And so she came in the waiting room, and I was in the waiting room also, and I think Marion was on the phone with one of her friends from the insurance company. So she made a lot of friends in insurance companies over the years. So I thought I'd talk to this woman while she was waiting. She didn't know I was a chiropractor. And I said, so you're here for a treatment from Dr. Bouma? She said, no, not really. And I said, oh, you're picking up some supplements. And she said, no, I'm not getting any supplements. And I said, oh, well, you're getting some physiotherapy. And she said, no, I'm not doing that. And so I said, well, why are you here? And she said, my horse died. So I'm thinking, she's going to ask Dr. Bouma to revive her horse. So I said, now he's a good, Dr. Bouma's a good doctor, he's a good chiropractor, but I don't think he can help your horse now. And she said, no, it's not for my horse. So she started to tell me the story of how she had had this horse for 25 years, and she worked a small ranch outside of Livingston. And she lived out on her own, and she just didn't know how she could go forward. And she's telling me this whole story about her ranch and her horse. And so I asked her again after a while. I said, well, so why are you here? And she said, well, I'm going to see Dr. Bouma. I'm going to tell him I have a hip problem, but I just really came to get a hug from Dr. Bouma. Now, in medical terminology, this is called malingering, when someone fakes an injury or an illness so they can get extended insurance payments. But here, this woman was malingering so she can get a hug from Dr. Bouma. So I saw her when she came out, And she said, I'm okay now. I got my hug. So that's one example. The second case I recall very clearly was a family that lived out near Three Forks, quite a ways away. And a woman, the mother, brought in her 7-year-old daughter. And she had an unusual case, a condition, where she had a fear of rain, going outdoors when it rained. And I had to look this up. It's called ombrophobia. And with that, she also had an obsession with the Weather Channel. She couldn't go out or make plans unless she saw the weather forecast. So if it was raining, she couldn't leave her house. So her mother said that they had been to doctors and psychiatrists and psychologists and hypnotists. They even saw a shaman. But they couldn't get this condition healed. And they had heard about Dr. Bouma and all the things that he did. So he had her get on the table, and he started working on her. And he got out his plates and his pendulum, and he went to work. And I was watching him, but I really didn't know what he was doing. I don't know if he knew what he was doing. But she was in there about an hour, and he was working with his plates and the energy of this woman and this young girl. And so about a month later, I was there when she came back with her mother, and she came in and said, Dr. Bouma, I can go out in the rain now. And her mother was just thrilled because it had been a few years where they were having to plan all their activities around the weather. So they were just thrilled. And how many people do you know would go to a chiropractor for a condition of a phobia of rain? But that was the extent of his reputation and his work. So one last story about his reputation relates to when he was a patient. Yeah, he came in one time when I was working there, and Marion, you probably remember this. He had a bad knee. He hurt his knee, and he was kind of hobbling around. And so when we had a break that day, I said that we should take a look at this. So we looked at him, rolled his pant leg up and looked at his knee, and it was ballooned up to twice its size. So I said, maybe you should have that checked out, medically. He said, well, we'll see. If I have to, if it doesn't go down, I'll go to get some medical treatment. So he did go right then. He worked during the week. And he was hobbling around literally like Chester, from Gunsmoke. He was treating all his patients, but his knee was ballooned up. So he did go to the hospital in Bozeman on the Saturday. And he told me this story himself. He probably never told this to anyone else because he was just so humble. He never talked a lot about his work. He let his work speak for him. But he went to the emergency room, and he said it was very busy. And there was about 10 people in front of him. So he filled out the paperwork, and he's sitting there among all these emergency patients. And a medical doctor comes out and says, is Dr. Bouma here? And so he raised his hand. The doctor said, come with me. So I took him in. Dr. Bouma's telling me this. He took him into his office, and he said, it's an honor to meet you. He shook his hand. He says, you have helped a lot of my patients recover from my surgeries. You've also helped them heal from conditions that I couldn't even treat. And Dr. Bouma didn't even know this man. So Dr. Bouma told him about his knee problem. He said, I've got a new procedure they just came out with, and some new equipment. He said, I'm going to treat your leg. And I said, I'm not going to charge you. So he worked on Dr. Bouma. He treated his knee, drained his knee. And Dr. Bouma said, well, what about the paperwork? And he said, don't worry about the paperwork. You don't have to pay anything. He said, here's my card. If that knee acts up again, just give me a call at home. So this was the extent of his reputation. That was a medical doctor, an orthopedic surgeon in Bozeman. And if you knew Dr. Bouma, he would never talk about this, but that's the extent of his reputation. So in finishing, I just want to say this is how I imagine Dr. Bouma when he got up to the other side after he passed. He's sitting in the big waiting room up in the sky, and he sees an angel across the room. And then he walks over to this angel, and he says, turn around. He says, one wing is lower than the other here. Just stick out, put your arm out, we'll test this. So I just have to say it was an honor to work with Dr. Bouma. It is an honor to be his friend and an honor to have learned from him. And we're just grateful for all the help and service you gave our community and everyone. So thank you, Dr. Bouma.
Thank you, Dr. Karp. Thank you very much. Mary Ellen Montz, she has a short little story to tell about Dr. B.
Well, I was one of the fortunate ones to be treated by him when he first joined staff because I was there, and I was there at the wedding. And the precious thing I wanted to share is something that Mark Prophet said to me as he was preparing to marry Merle and Margie. And he just looked at me and he said, "That is a truly chaste man, and I don't see very many of them." And I thought that was so precious, and I've held it in my heart all these years. And about maybe 6 weeks ago, Merle came to the Bozeman Teaching Center, and I told him that. And he said, "What does that mean?" I said, "Merle, I think it means that your soul is very pure." And he was so grateful to hear that. So thank you.
Thank you, Mary Ellen. Marla Bray.
Those of you who knew Dr. Bouma over these many years and affectionately called him Doc will know of his beloved wife and help meet Margie. Margie was warm, loving, beautiful, and kind. She was the softer side of Merle. Together they built Doc's healing practice. She was, for Merle, the still waters that run deep. Though Merle came from a large family, he and Margie married later in life and had no children of their own. Instead, Margie brought family to Merle. In their marriage with her two children, Marlene and Tom. And he was grandfather to many grandchildren as well. Merle widened that circle of loving through his many years of love and service with Marion O'Neill as his friend, helper, adopted daughter, and receptionist, and her beautiful daughter, Shay. I had Shay when she was 12 years old in seventh grade. Merle well knew family in many senses of the word. When Margie left us, there was quite a void for Doc. Family and friends filled it the best we all could. It was after she left us that Doc lovingly shared with friends with quiet pride the poetry album that he had of Margie's writings, written in her still moments of centering and reflection. Marlene has given permission for two of these poems to be shared with you today. Sharon and Charles Witteman have been good friends to Doc, were there for him in all ways, and gave him great care during these last years and months of his life. Sharon proposed the poem that I will read today. She felt that all of us could relate to Margie's words, which capture the journey of a long marriage with its growth and challenges, and equally the journey and experience and sacrifice of losing oneself in the higher service of one's sacred labor, one's service to God and to life. Both were devoted to Merle's mission to heal. It was their mission to heal. Marlene expressed to me the desire to read this poem to you herself, but was not able to do so today. She expressed her regrets and asked that I share it with you. I pray that Margie's poem will bring comfort to her family and bring a smile to all of us. How wonderful and appropriate that we can add Margie's voice today, sharing her love and adoration, welcoming to the holy city her beloved Merle. I had no time to write a poem to tell you of my love. It was a time of which I've heard when push would turn to shove. The push began about the time that I became your wife, and we dedicated our union to the freeing of mankind's strife. It seemed a noble thing to do, a life of service that was simple. I'd balance out the books, and you'd balance the body temples. I'd smile at people and just be kind as I collected all the money. You'd fix their body aches and pains and make them feel bright and sunny. But soon we learned that service doesn't come with just a smile. God often expects his chelas to go another mile. Another mile. Another mile. Back and forth across the country. We were pushed to travel far. Until at times we lost the dream to hitch our wagon to the star. So often we found our wagon stuck. How hard we pushed to make it move. And all the while God tested us to see if faith and love we'd prove. We sold our office, left the children, gave away our little home, traveled far across the desert to serve beside the ocean's foam. At Lanello Reserves, the push became shove. We worked till we nearly bust. God let us retreat about the time I was ready to bite the dust. Back to the drawing board we went, plotting and planning anew, searching for jobs, school books, and tests. I thought we would never plow through. But every time the push got too much and we were ready to throw in the glove, God came along with the blessed heavenly host to get behind us and shove. Out of the mire and on solid ground, we'd sail again to the top of the hill. We learned how much life can be enjoyed with very little money in the till. The ocean was free, and so was the sky. The mountains belong to our God. Elemental life became our friends. We took our food from earth's sod. Our love wasn't based on fancy clothes, so we didn't need the latest expensive look. We both had learned a long time ago, a cover doesn't tell the worth of a book. From ocean to ocean we have traveled. We've seen a lot of service in between. Someday we'll be established in the holy city, the fulfillment of our dearest dream. One day we'll walk the streets of gold. The push will be over and so will the shove. We'll know at last the peace of home, held safe and secure in our Father's love. Then I'll have time to be your wife and say the things you ought to hear. But now I've got to get to work. Belated happy anniversary, dear.
Thank you so much, Marla. And now our dear friend, Fred Mosfell.
Good afternoon, everyone. Many years ago, when I began working professionally in the theater in New York, going to auditions, voice classes, rehearsals, etc., an actress friend of mine said that one of the most interesting things about being an actor is that in doing a number of different roles and characters, you learn so much about yourself. It turned out she was right. As I look back at that time, I realize that working in the theater was the spark that ignited my interest in following a spiritual path, which in 1984 led me to California, the Summer Lighthouse, where I was given the opportunity to find out why I am who I am. About a year later, I was looking for a chiropractor, and a couple of friends at Camelot, which is the name of our church headquarters in Malibu at the time, suggested that I call someone named Dr. Bouma. And he was at the place called the Center for the Disciplines of Wholeness, which I think was located somewhere behind a place called, graphics or something like that, some big building. Well, I did. I called him on the phone, and he said he would see me. And my first treatment with Dr. Bouma, was in April of 1985, 32 years ago. And I realized after that first treatment that this was not some ordinary health practitioner. This guy was really good and really special. I took my mother to see him too on a few occasions, and both she and I gave him a nickname, the Good Hands Doctor. So the church moved to Montana, and he opened his practice here in Livingston, and I was able to see him on a more regular basis. And our friendship then began to grow almost exponentially. And it turned out that my office visits very quickly became more than simply correcting an injured sacral area, eliminating a headache, or adjusting the axis in my neck. Because we'd find ourselves discussing all kinds of current events. He was always informed about politics and politicians in the news, and he invariably helped me to understand them by bringing the circumstances of that event back to their spiritual causes and helping me to see the spiritual solutions to the problems. Very often he would say to me, call for the exposure. Call for the exposure. I've been hearing that word for the last 20 odd years, I think. I remember one time in the early 90s, I came in for a treatment and he asked me how I was doing. And I told him that I was really tired. And as I kept complaining, you know, kind of gently while he was working on my body, he asked me what I had had for breakfast. I told him some cereal and probably a piece of toast or something like that. And then he asked me if that's what I normally ate for breakfast in the morning. And I said, oh yeah, usually. By 10 o'clock in the morning, however, I'm climbing the walls and I don't understand why. So I'll have more cereal, another piece of toast. And then he said, I have a test here that I want you to take, and then we'll see what we can do. So he gave me this test, which was a number of questions on 3 or 4 pages about my daily habits, what time did I get up, what time did I go to bed, did I take a nap in the afternoon, so on and so forth. I took the test home and I filled it out, took it back to him the very next day, because I knew that something was going on and I wanted to get an answer right away. Now there are 3 different conclusions to be determined from the answers, which stated how much protein a person should have at every meal. He looked at it and he said, well, according to this, 45 to 50% of every meal you eat should be protein, like fish or chicken. And I thought to myself, well, wait a minute, that sounds like having a meal. That's like having dinner in the morning. And then he added, but try it for a couple of days and we'll see what happens. Now I had, by this time, been going to see him for several years, and I had gotten past questioning any suggestions he made to me about my health because he was always right. The next morning, about 7:30, I got up, had a cup of coffee to make sure I could open my eyes, and I fixed a piece of salmon. Then I went about my activities. Sometime in the mid-afternoon, I will never forget this, I went into the kitchen to get some juice, and I realized that I had not thought about food for nearly 7 hours. And I was absolutely amazed, and I said, I can't wait to call him and tell him what's going on. So I called him that evening after he got finished at the office, and you know what his response to me was? I'm sure you all have heard this same kind of thing from him. He just said over the phone, good. Keep it up. And I have now for more than 20 years. Now, as you all know, Dr. B, I know a lot of people called him Merle. I called him Dr. Bouma for the first few years, but when we became good friends and I could share a lot of things with him and he shared a few things with me, I just could never call him by his first name. So one day I hit on calling him Dr. B, and he didn't seem to mind, so I just called him Dr. B from that point to this. He had a delicious sense of humor. Once when I was getting a treatment, we were talking about Mark Prophet's sense of humor. And I mentioned one of the sermons for a Sabbath evening, albums that I had heard, in which Mark had interrupted his sermon and said to someone who was sitting in the front of the congregation, and I think this is the Colorado Springs, and you can hear him on the tape, he says, go to my office and get the laughing bag. And you can hear that laughing bag coming down the hall. And Dr. B said, yeah, I was there when he did that. And I said, really? He said, yep. And the two of us then had a boat kind of cracked up. It was very funny. But a few months later, I was in an airport early in the morning coming home, from Florida. And as I went into one of those little newspaper magazine places, you know, to get a bottle of water, because we all had to drink a lot of water. And that was before the TSA told us that we couldn't carry anything like that on the plane. So in any case, I was paying for my bottle of water at the register, and as I did so, I glanced up and there was a shelf, and on the shelf were 5 brown bags that said, laughing bag. And I said, I don't believe this. So I went over there and I pulled one of them off and I hit the button and the thing started giggling and cackling all over, it was hysterical. So I said, I gotta get 2 of them. So I bought 2, and I could hardly wait to get home because the flight got in early in the afternoon. And I got to Bozeman, got in the car, drove here, and the first place I came was the office. Now, I don't know who was his receptionist at the time. I don't think it was Marion. But in any case, I walked in, and I said, is he in the office? And I think he was in room 1. And she said, yes, he's there. And I said, you want me to get him? I said, no. So I took the bag, and I put it on the counter, and I hit the button. My friends, I stood there for about maybe 10 seconds. The door opened up. He's standing there in the doorway with this huge grin on his face. And you know how he was laughing? His shoulders were kind of hunched up like that. And he was just shaking like that. No sound, just having a wonderful laugh. For me, that was the height of the day, and I just loved it. He had a wonderful, infectious kind of humor. Now, I have no idea where those laughing bags are. I know mine is long since gone. He's probably worn out as well. One day, I remember he was giving me a treatment, and as I looked at him, I realized that he was wearing a really pretty shirt, and I said to him, you know, that's a beautiful shirt. I said, did you get that? He said, no, Margie bought it. That became a running gag that lasted for the next 25 years. Every time I'd see him, because he always dressed well, and what he always did was he'd take the tie, and the way we do it in the military, he'd take it and fold it underneath the buttons here, you know, so it'd be out of the way so he could work. And it became a running gag, and I always say to him, did you buy that shirt? Nope, Margie did. Did you buy that shirt? No, Margie did. And I'm very happy that I can say today the shirt I'm wearing is one he bought me. Now, he told a story that I enjoyed asking him to repeat on a number of occasions. When the headquarters was still in California, he needed to get guidance from the messenger about a particular situation that was going on at the Center for the Discipline of Wholeness. And I think what was happening was that he had been working with someone he was training to be like his receptionist and secretary there. And a couple of days earlier, apparently, things had changed and she was not going to be there any longer. And he had to get in touch with the messenger to find out what could he do, because this is like on a Friday or a Thursday night or a Friday. And so to make a long story short, he called the office, he kept trying to get in touch with her, and nobody would return a phone call. And he was getting very desperate. So finally, he said on Saturday, I think it was a Saturday, he wrote a letter to Lanello. And Lanello, of course, is the ascended master name for beloved Mark Prophet. So he wrote a letter to Mark Titillanello, and he said, I need your help. You got to help me get to her because I got to get the answer before she leaves. Because at the time, we all knew, or they all knew, that mother was going away somewhere over about 2 or 3 days or a couple of weeks or whatever. So he said, please help me. He burned it, which is what you do to get the letter to make sure it gets up there fast, rather than waiting for the police, for the post office. In any case, he went to bed this Saturday night and woke up very early in the morning on Sunday. It was about 5:15, 5:20, maybe 5:30. And when he woke up, the only thing in his head were the words, call her now. And he looked at the clock and he said, it's 5:25 in the morning. I can't call her, and I'm not sure that I should do that. But the words in his head did not leave. And so finally he decided, he said, to take the bull by the horns. He picked up the phone and called her. The phone was picked up on one ring, even before the first ring was over. And it was the secretary. And he said, I need to speak to the messenger. And so the next thing he knew, she was on the phone. She said, I'm on my way out. I'm going to the airport right now. What do you need? He told her what was the problem. She gave him the answer, and 30 seconds later, everything was over. And he was sitting there, he said, sitting in bed, just having had this conversation with her. And then he thought, how did this happen? And then he realized that he was hearing two other words, or several other words in his head. And those words were, well, you did write me, didn't you? Now, if you want to know the rest of that story, you can ask Mrs. Denise Orr Kirk, because she has the rest of that story. I won't fill it in. I won't take her thunder. I'll just let her tell you about what is later on. Now, over the many years that I've known Dr. Bowman, many of you know that I do these performances on the life of Frederick Douglass. And there have been many, many times, more than I can count, when I have done something silly. Frequently when I'm on the road, I remember once I was coming out of an airport and I had this huge case that I carried that weighed about 45 pounds, and the guy who was helping me to get it into the car, he had to go around to open the door or something like that. To make a long story short, I reached down, picked this thing up, and put it in there, and of course my back flew completely out. For the next 2 weeks I was living with ice on my back. So whenever things like this would happen, I would call him and he would tell me what I should do, or if I were here, I could come in and see him. I would always apologize to him for bringing him a body that was nearly falling apart. But he would go quietly to work, and he would put Humpty Dumpty back together again. And when I thanked him, he would always simply say, well, we have to keep you going. And he always did. I think we all know how he was constantly attending weekend medical seminars and conferences, because he had an insatiable determination to learn everything he could, particularly in his world of healing. A few years ago, I think it was maybe 5 years ago, I asked him if he would consider becoming a member of the board of directors of my nonprofit company, which sponsors my programs that I do on Douglass's life. Well, he did, and our friendship really deepened after that. I so appreciated his insights because he had the background of healing and spiritual maturity that helped me to keep focused on the true solutions to many of the conditions that I see as I travel and that are so prevalent today in the news. Racial, gender, ethnic polarization. That from my perspective, looking back, seem worse now than, if it's possible, than it did during some of the most difficult times of the civil rights struggle in the 1950s and the 1960s. Being intolerant and easily provoked to anger is apparently considered by many in the mass media, in the entertainment world, to be badges of honor instead of what they really are, signs of ignorance and moral degeneracy. There were a number of times when I was on the road and I'd hear a news report about some awful thing that had happened somewhere in the country, and I'd call him. Usually not when he was in the office, unless I could leave a message for him. I'd tell him what was on my mind, and he would listen on the other end of the phone, and then I would say, well, thanks, Dr. B, for letting me get this stuff off my chest. and his response was virtually always the same. Sure, anytime. I'll tell you another funny story. I was performing in an elementary school somewhere, I think it was in New Jersey, and I had two performances to give this particular morning, and I just finished the first performance, and I had forgotten that on my table where I was getting myself together, I had a bottle of 99% isopropyl alcohol, and I used it because it's very strong to take off the wig and the spirit gum and all the other things that are there. I was very thirsty, unfortunately, and in my haste, I forgot which bottle was which. You can imagine I picked up what I thought was the water bottle and took a huge swig. It was not water. As soon as I realized what I had done, I grabbed the water and drank it all, hoping that that would dilute the alcohol in my stomach. For a minute, I was more than a little frightened that I might have done something really serious, because that stuff is very strong, 99% isopropyl alcohol. So I called Dr. B on my phone, and whoever the receptionist was, I said, I gotta talk to him right now because I've done something really, really stupid. So there was a pause. He came, I told him what had happened, and then there was a longer pause that went on even longer than that. And then I heard him laughing. He then suggested, between his legs, he said, I suggest that you drink whatever you can find, preferably not alcohol. Get a Coca-Cola or a soda, coffee, anything that you can. And then he said, when I'm done with the second performance, call him and let him know how I'm doing. So the alcohol did go a little bit to my head, but I did survive. And I did tell myself then that what I did could not have been but so bad because, after all, he did laugh. Dr. B made his transition on May 17th. That's a very significant date. Some of you may not know this, so I'll share it with you. 63 years ago, this past May 17th, the United States Supreme Court delivered their decision in Brown versus Board of Education of Topeka, Kansas. It was the decision that overturned the doctrine of separate but equal in the United States of America. The doctrine that empowered and sustained state-sponsored racial segregation in this nation. It was the decision that proved to be the necessary spark for the American Civil Rights Movement of the 1950s, 60s, and the early 70s. Now, I believe that there is something profound about these two events occurring on the same date. Dr. Merle Bouma could not judge people by their externals, skin color, height, gender, age, because he was so completely, so totally wedded to the light. He was a remarkable listener, and he was a wonderful sounding board for me. His very practical spiritual awareness and understanding was always tinged with a light touch of humor that must have endeared him to Mark Prophet. I don't think there is anyone who ever left his office after a treatment or a visit with him at the house or going out somewhere to have a cup of coffee without always feeling lighter and more centered than when they first got there. Like Mark Prophet, Dr. B was the embodiment of a magnanimous heart and a magnanimous soul. I am very grateful that he was and remains a very wise friend. Some of you know, and now you've heard from Marla, that his wife Margie was a poet, and she wrote many incisive and beautifully expressed poems. With Marlene's permission, I'd like to share this one with you that she wrote 19 years ago for his 64th birthday. She titled it, Call Him What You Will. To some, he's a brother, just one of a dozen. For a seeming multitude, nephew. To so many, he is a cousin. His mother called him son. Those 64 years have passed. A birth certificate reads, Merle first, Bouma last. All his life he's been a student. For knowledge he seems to yearn. I've heard him say so often, from everyone I can learn. At times he's been the teacher, and wisdom through him would flow, as he stood before a group and shared what he did know. I've seen him be so gentle with the tiniest little child, and one who calls him grandpa can easily win him with a smile. Again, there are many grown-ups who won't believe he is so mild, for they have heard him roar like a storm gone wild. He bears the title doctor. It's a degree hard-earned. Healing is his sacred labor, and this, I have discerned, is the very core of his being. In this particular time and space, if karma would allow it, he'd heal the whole human race. There is no hour so early, there is no time so late, that he is not willing to treat one with illness as their fate. This willingness to serve has made him friend to many. Of some he has asked fair wage, and of others not a penny. He could be called counselor, though he wouldn't like the name, yet some who have known him would say it's true just the same. For many who came burdened with their body's aches and pains have discerned higher healing when taught of other planes. As he took time to sit with them and wade through frets and tears, he showed them their biggest enemy was their own doubts and fears. While he treated the physical body, he treated their spiritual too. For a short while in their lives, he was truly their guru. To at least one child I know, he is their savior on earth, because he convinced an unwed mother that baby had a right to birth. He never bore the name of father, though my children love him dearly. And you can bet on Father's Day, a special card will come yearly. He is not always gracious. To some, he is far too blue. If they knew him as well as I, they'd see the pink peeping through. His heart is big and loving. However tough may seem his hide, there is a pearl of great price within that rough outside. To God, he has a special name, a name no one can know, a secret name to be revealed when the carnal mind does go. And somewhere in our cosmic space is one who seems the same. To that blessed beloved one, he will be called Twin Flame. But for a while, here and now, I shall walk by his side, because one day, those years ago, he called me his bride. I never understood and never will what he really saw in me, but I am so very, very glad to be a part of his family tree. It doesn't matter what you call him. It wouldn't change him a bit. He has learned the age-old lesson, under your own fig tree, a man must sit. The virtues bestowed upon him are gifts from God, you know. What is stored in his causal body is as above, so below. So, my dearest husband, upon this very special day, there really isn't any more that I to you can say than to tell you that I love you, that I am glad to be your wife, and I'll stick like glue beside you through all our trials and strife. We'll share the joy and laughter, the good time and the bad. We'll walk life's path together and learn the lessons to be had. Then when this life is over, they can call us Sue or Sam. It isn't going to matter a jot. We'll both just be I am.
Thank you very much, Fred. Now, somebody took my pages here, so which I do need. Yeah. Let us sing In the Garden, song number 77. Is in your bulletin. Together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, I am. I am thy kingdom come. I am thy will being done. I am on earth even as I am in heaven. I am giving this day daily bread to all. I am forgiving all life this day, even as I am also all life forgiving me. I am leading all men away from temptation. I am delivering all men from every evil condition. I am the kingdom, I am the power, and I am the glory of God in eternal, immortal manifestation. All this I am. Thank you. Please be seated. I have a letter that was written to Merle and Margie
from our beloved Mother Elizabeth Clare Prophet. This was April 17th, 1999. And after this letter, we have a very short audio excerpt clip that Merle gave a few years ago, and you'll get to hear his voice. So we'll get to have a final word from Merle. Dear Merle and Margie, I have been thinking of you lately. You have both been wonderful chelas through thick and thin, and I am blessed to know you. Merle, you have been there for me whenever I needed you, as recently as 2 days ago. From the bottom of my heart, I thank you for your generosity. Sweet Margie, I want to express my gratitude for the service you rendered to the Great White Brotherhood and to me personally. Merle and Margie, I love your hearts, plain and simple. The purity of your souls is touching. May God's blessing be with you. All my love, Mother.
In 1977, the church had moved to Pasadena, California. We were at this campus, and we were there for 2 years. It was a Nazarene college or something like that. One day, Mother said to me, I want you to set up an office near the campus, and where you can treat the staff and also treat people in the local community. So we find this office, this duplex that we converted into an office. We had all the remodeling done. And she said to me, have you thought of a name for this? I said, I haven't been able to come up with anything. She said, how about calling it the Center for the Disciplines of Wholeness? I said, that sounds pretty good to me. Do you think it would be okay here? I said, this is California, anything will go. And I said, where did you get that name? She said, Portia gave it to me. I said, it'll do, it'll work. I realized that what Mother wanted to see was a healthcare center that included all healthcare practitioners to be a part of this, and that was her vision for Center for the Community. So by the time we moved to Camelot in 1978, CDW had been pretty well established and everything was. We started this center in 1977 in Pasadena. 78, we moved to Camelot. And then in February of 87, by that time, we had pretty well moved to the ranch, and I came up there, and we were then trying to continue this health center up there. And then I left staff in the summer of 87, and I started my practice in Livingston. But what I was taught by my teachers is holistic thinking. Holistic consciousness, as I call it. Because if we can go back to the original philosophy of chiropractic, because that's how I was trained, it was established originally by the Palmer family. A man by the name of Daniel David Palmer, way back in the late 1800s. And by 1897, I think he established a school called Palmer Cure and School. And he taught that the healing comes from within. And that's what he wanted to get across.
Let us remember the immortal words of St. Paul. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. For the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ.
One day at the organ, I was weary and ill at ease, and my fingers wandered idly over the noisy keys. I know not what I was playing, or what I was dreaming then, but I struck one chord of music like the sound of a great amen, like the sound of a close of an angel's song, and it lay on my fevered spirit with a touch of infinite calm. It quieted pain and sorrow like love overcoming strife. It seemed the harmonious echo from our discordant mind. It linked all perplexed meanings into one perfect peace, and trembled away into silence as if it were loath to cease. I have sought, but I seek it vainly, that one lost chord divine that came from the soul of the organ and entered into mine. It may be that death's bright angel will speak in that chord again. It may be that only in heaven we shall hear that great amen. It may be that death's bright angel will speak in that chord. It may.
rise for the benediction and the extinguishing of the candles. In the name of our Father, Mother God, we are grateful to be together to celebrate the soul of Merle Bouma and his great victory. We ask that you give us the insights of what makes a soul travel on and be constant to his God. We ask that we may embody all of the beautiful qualities of his heart and his healing presence and those of his friends and family. We are grateful to be together as we finish our work this day in the victory of the light, and we pray that he may make his ascension in the light according to God's holy will. We thank thee and accept it done. In the name of the Father, the Mother, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Thank you, everyone, for joining us. And we would invite you to please spend some time in our fellowship room downstairs, and there's easy exit off to this side, and share your stories with beloved Merle Bouma and his friends and family. Thank you again. May God bless you.